Hello, welcome back to my channel. I'm Heather Stamper, in case you didn't read the name of the title. And I am working on my NaNoWriMo, my Camp NaNoWriMo project, which is to complete my in-progress novel. Now, I mentioned this before in my earlier videos about how I'm not satisfied with the beginning of my novel. I feel it's kind of weak. So I had to think about what do I need to do to really pump this up? And I had to think like a student here and remember what I tell my students all the time about when they're writing. Look at your favorite books to help you figure out what's the best way to get your reader engaged in your writing. We call these hooks, okay? It's something that gets the reader's attention, and it's up to you to keep the reader's attention. So first things first, your title of your novel is supposed to be part of your hook. Now, Nibble Nibble, while it may not sound like the most fancy go-getter title, Nibble Nibble, well, it does give the mind of something to eat. And I imagine that would be something on the cover, maybe some gingerbread or something. But there's also a phrase in the Hansel and Gretel stories. It goes, nibble, nibble, little mouse, who is nibbling at my house? That's what the witch says when she is first coming across Hansel and Gretel. So I figured nibble, nibble, to start that line, would be a good place to give the title. But let's take a look at some other books and see if we can find what makes these compelling reads. Now, I pulled the ones from my students' bookshelves because it was faster, okay? But you can do this with any books that you have. Or even if you can't think of a book, you can also use a movie. You know, think about how movies are introduced. You know, is it a wide panning shot of the countryside and then it zooms in on the car driving by? Does it start off with the characters arguing about something? Something that gets the attention? A big, massive explosion, you know. So this is George's Marvelous Medicines by Roald Dahl. It's one of his lesser known books. And when you're looking at the hook, you're looking at the first couple sentences, no more than the first page. Because if you don't have the reader's attention by the end of the first page, especially as a novel, then you need to rethink yourself. I'm going shopping in the village, George's mother said to George on a Saturday afternoon, so be a good boy and don't get into mischief. Okay, what's got my attention here is that word mischief. Obviously, this kid can be a troublemaker. Why not? It's a Roald Dahl book, right? So the fact that mom is saying don't get into mischief makes me wonder, what's going to happen? What is he going to do? Because obviously, he's going to get into some kind of trouble. Otherwise, there would be no book. So sometimes books will begin with characters talking with the quotation marks, and that works out fine. Here is Superfudge, Judy, Blume, classic. Life was going along okay when my mother and father dropped the news. Bam! Just like that. I like that they give the reader's opinion since it's first person. And boy, that gives your attention right there. Life was going fine. Then there's some news and it just happened that quickly. Bam. Well, that's going to get somebody's attention, isn't it? Reading on. We have something wonderful to tell you, Peter, Mom said before dinner. She was slicing carrots into a salad bowl and I grabbed one. What is it? I asked. I figured maybe my father's been made president of the company, or maybe my teacher phoned saying that even though I don't get the best grades in fifth grade, I am definitely the smartest kid in class. We're going to have a baby, Mom said. We're going to what? I said, starting to choke. Now, if you remember anything about Judy Blume, Peter and his brother Farley, aka Fudge, he's not a big fan. So having another baby in the house, you know that shenanigans are about to begin. Another classic, Cricket in Times Square by George Selden. A mouse was looking at Mario. The mouse's name was Tucker, and he was sitting on an opening of an abandoned drain pipe in the subway station at Times Square. The drain pipe was his home. Back a few feet in the wall, it opened out into a pocket that Tucker had filled with bits of paper and shreds of cloth he collected. And when he wasn't collecting, scrounging, as he called it, or sleeping, he liked to sit at the opening of the drain pipe and watch the world go by. At least as much of the world as hurried through Times Square subway station. Tucker finished the last few crumbs of a cookie he was eating, a Lorna Doone shortbread he had found earlier in the evening, and licked off his whiskers. Such a pity, he sighed.
There's a lot of background information. You get a good picture in your mind of what the setting is, which is fine. I mean, this is a very successful book. It is a Newbery Honor book for a reason, right? And you get a little action from the character. Why is this mouse looking at Mario? Who is Mario? What makes him so special? Why does this mouse care? Okay. And we know that the story is going to be told third person, but from the perspective of the mouse. So while it may not be the most zazzy of introductions, you do get a general idea, and it does lead you to ask a question. Well, what's so special about this Mario guy? Horrible Harry and the Ant Invasion by Suzy Kline.
When Harry and I walked into room 2B, we couldn't believe our eyes. Look at that, I said. Wow, what is it, Doug? Harry asked me.
Okay, you got my attention already, all right? Walked into the room, couldn't believe their eyes. Apparently they saw something really amazing, and they're talking at each other. So those are the types of hooks. It's something quick. It gets their attention, makes them think and ask a question, and then it's up to you to lead the rest of the way. So now we're going to take a look at what my introduction is, and we'll see where I can maybe make it a bit better. Okay, so here is my first couple of paragraphs. Now, even as I was beginning to write this, I wasn't quite sure where to start. So I just kind of picked a point and worked from there, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes it can lead to some nice surprises. So here's what I have. Hilda, these mint leaves are not fresh. Go out into the herb garden and pick some that aren't shriveled. Hilda's grandmother chided. But grandmother, it's raining. Well then, wear your slicker and your wellies and don't stay out too long. I cannot have you catching a cold. You're serving tonight. Hilda's grandmother always said that the only way to make the best food is with fresh ingredients. Dried or wilted weren't any good. She was lucky that she was related to the best chef and baker in the kingdom. If any of her kitchen maids tried to give her anything less than fresh, they would be sent packing. Hilda just had to go back out in whatever weather to get the better selection. Not bad. It's not a bad way to start. Got the characters talking, just like in the other books that I had just shared. What I really don't care for is this paragraph here, this little nugget of info dumping here. What I think I will do with this, though, is maybe I'll have Hilda come and talk to the servant that, you know, brought the mint leaves in and explain to her why this was a bad idea and how she's got to go out and get fresh and get better mint leaves for the dinner. So I think I will do that. I think I will activate this section right here. I'm going to activate this section and see if I can't punch it up a little bit. Okay, so I transformed that paragraph into a bit of dialogue here. I threw in a minor inconsequential character, I'll write her off in the next part, named Ellen, who it's her fault that the mint leaves were less than prime. And so I changed it to this. Thanks a lot, Ellen. Hilda muttered to the trembling child in the dirt-stained smock. I'm sorry, Hilda. Ellen helped her into her coat. They were in the back of the pantry, and I didn't want them to go to waste. You're new, so if you want to keep your job, listen carefully. Grandmother only wants the best food in the freshest ingredients. Catch those missing words. The freshest ingredients for King Stefan. Dried or wilted aren't any good. Bundle up. I'll show you how to pick fresh mint. So there's an introduction that makes I feel better about, you know, it's like it flows better. It's less telling than if I just left it as the minor info dump there. you know, you still got the same information across. She works at a castle. Doesn't mention her being head chef, but that won't be that hard to figure out soon enough. It gives information about how strict she is. So I feel much better about this. And I can segue it into my next section and it will work. So excellent. So I'm glad you were with me to go over these different strategies of how to find the best hook. Again, you can always check books, check movies, how they're being introduced, what gets the reader or the viewer's attention, and then don't copy it, but use kind of that kind of style. I use the format of the characters talking. And most of the books that were really compelling that I showed you guys had characters that were in a conversation, in a dialogue, and got their attention pretty quick. So something action-packed or something where there's dialogue is going to help you get your audience hooked in, and then into the rest of the story you go. So I hope this was helpful. If you like this video, please click like and subscribe. Hit the notification bell so you know when I'm posting next. And I will see you in the next video. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.